Hello. So we have been discussing UCB algorithm. We introduced it briefly last time. So this is one of the algorithm based on optimism in the face of uncertainty. So the UCB algorithm is said that it combines both exploration and exploitation together. Unlike ETC algorithm, which first did exploration and then did exploitation separately in a subsequent rounds, it combines exploration and exploitation in each step by looking into upper confidence bounds of the arms in each round. So in UCP algorithm, we are going to So, like I said last time, UCB is a like index-based algorithm in which we are going to assign an index to each arm, and based on the value of this indices, we are going to pick an arm. So, we are going to pick the arm with the highest index in this. So, what is the index in the UCB algorithm? The index of the UCB algorithm for arm I at time t is defined to be mu hat of I t minus 1 plus alpha log t divided by t of t minus 1. So what is this? This we said as this is the estimate based on the number of samples of arm I have observed till time t minus 1, and here this is the confidence term here, which basically determines the confidence width of my estimates. And here, how did we define ti t minus 1? This is the number of pulls of I over. So maybe I should write it as s equals to 1 to. So recall that is here denotes the arm I am going to pull in round s, and depending on how many times I have pulled this arm I over t minus n rounds, this is going to give me ti of t minus 1. And based on this, this is just a recall of power notation. We said that this is nothing but summation of all over s equals to t minus 1 times, what is this? We said this is xi of s. What is xi s? This is the sample observed from arm I if you have pulled it in round s. It is not necessary that you would have pulled it in round s. If at all you pulled it, that is the indicator here, then you are going to include that sample in the summation, and the whole of this divided by s equals to t minus 1 indicator of I of s equals to I. Or just to be t minus 1 and I t equals to I times x I s divided by t I t minus 1. Okay. I am also, so notice that when I said mu I hat till time t minus 1, that means this is going to be a random quantity based on the t I t minus 1 sample you have observed till round t minus 1. Okay. So a priori you do not know how many samples of arm I would have observed till t minus 1. So, t I t minus here is a random quantity. But suppose I fix this number. Suppose, let us say till round t minus 1, I said that I have observed exactly certain number of samples. Then for that, I am going to use this notation, maybe u I will use. So when I use this, this I mean to say that I have exactly u number of samples till round t minus 1, and I am going to use them to find this estimate. So when I wrote this notation, this is whatever be the number of samples I have observed till t minus 1, that was t minus 1, I am going to use this to find average. But somehow if I fix this number of samples to have been observed till t minus 1 to be u, then I am going to use this notation. And in this case, it is simply going to be right. So this u is this u, which is I am taking as number of samples of arm I. Okay. Now our goal is to come up with what will be the regret of my UCB algorithm, which works, which selects arm like this in each round. Okay, now to prove the regret bound of this, we are going to use the regret decomposition result that we have shown last time. Let's recall that we said that mu star is the mean of the highest mean we have across all the arms, and we are going to denote I star to be arg max of mu I over I. Okay. So this I star, we are going to call it as optimal arm, and all other I which are not I star, we are going to call them as suboptimal arm. For all I such that I, we are going to call them as suboptimal arms. Last time we also denoted this del I, which said the gap between the means of the ith arm and the optimal arm, mu star minus mu I, right. And we also said delta to be minimum value of I not equals to I star of delta I. Okay. And this term we are going to call it as suboptimality gap of arm I, and this we will simply call it as suboptimality gap. So we also going to assume that the unique arm, sorry, the optimal arm is unique. Because of that, we are this guy is going to be positive in our case. Okay, fine. This was the notation, and with this notation, we have defined that regret of any policy over n round can be given as expected number of pulls times of AI I running from 1 to k, right. Now to bound the regret of our UCB algorithm, we will just try to bound what is the expected number of pulls of each arms, and in particular expected number of pulls of the suboptimal arms. So if you have a bound on this, we will directly get a bound on the regret of my UCB algorithm. Okay, so now how to go about this? Okay, let's start the proof of UCB algorithm. Assume that in round T, An arm, arm I is played. A suboptimal arm is played. Played. And let in round T. Suboptimal arm I is played in round T. Okay, what I am saying is IT is equals to some I, and where this I is not I star. Now, what could be the reason that this suboptimal arm has been selected in round I? One possibility is this estimate of this, the UCB index of this suboptimal arm happen to be very high in this. Obviously, if it is selected in this round I, it must be the case that it is the arm I should be the one which has the highest UCB index. Then the question is, what is the reason that this arm happened to have the highest UCB index? Obviously, it could be because somehow my estimates are not good in this case. Okay, let's visualize this. Let's say this is my mu I and this is my mu 1. Okay, by the way, we are going to assume that without loss of generality, arm 1 is the optimal one. So, we are going to take this I star is 1, that is arm 1 is optimal. So, let's say this is the mean of the optimal arm is here, and true mean of I term is here. So, now it might happen that when we construct confidence intervals of these arms, the confidence intervals may or may not include these bounds, and this confidence intervals may overshoot or undershoot these true values. Okay. Suppose this guy has been selected in round I, and let us say and the optimal arm is not selected in that. One possibility could be it has so happened that this guy happened to lie my confidence bounds, whatever, let us say my UCB, my confidence bounds, let me just call it as confidence term. Okay, let me directly write the confidence term we have already discussed. The confidence term we are going to use is this part here, right? Whatever this term happened to be, and like this, and for arm it happened to be like they overestimated it. In this, the confidence term of this happened to be like mu I hat plus alpha log t here, alpha log t divided by t I t minus 1, and this lower term happened to be mu I hat of minus alpha log t t I t minus 1. Because of this, you see that obviously this arm gets a preference over this arm because its UCB index is this. So, this is one possibility, that is the intervals for the suboptimal arm actually overshoot, and they overestimated its value, and it is telling that my intervals are telling that the true value of mu i's are here, but it is actually below this. Whereas, for the optimal arm, the true value of the mean happens to be here, but my confidence interval said that that is going to lie here. Because of this bad case, I may end up missing my optimal arm. Other possibility is that I have not sampled my arm I sufficiently enough. Because of this, my T I for the I term is smaller, And this term happens to be larger and made it dominate, made its ECB index dominate over the others. So other possibility is that the TI at round 1 is small. I is not sampled enough. So because of these reasons, maybe let's call 1, 2, 3, we ended up possibly choosing arm I, which is suboptimal in this round. So putting these three conditions more formally, so what is this condition is saying? Mu I hat minus alpha log t divided by ti t minus 1 happens to be larger than mu I, and mu 1 hat plus alpha log t ti t minus 1 happens to be less than mu 1, and let's say and this guy ti I square by 4. Now the claim is if a suboptimal arm I has been played in round T, that it means it must be the case that at least one of these three conditions must hold. If I t is equals to I in round T, at least one of 1, 2, 3 must hold. Okay, now let's see why this claim holds true. Okay, so how to prove this claim? We are going to show that suppose none of them holds true, none of this condition hold true, then we are going to argue that then it must be the case that IT should not have played in this round T. Okay, so we are going to assume that neither 1, 2, 3 are true, that is assume then we will show that that means IT that is can't be I in round T. Okay, so to show that, let's assume that first let's this condition is violated. So that means I have mu 1 hat plus alpha log T divided by TI T minus 1. So by the way, this is not a T here, we will take it as N. Okay. N is what? N is the number of rounds this algorithm is played for. This guy is taken to be mu 1, and now our definition of suboptimality gap, this should be equals to mu I plus delta I, right? So we have taken this case, we are assuming that this does not hold. Now let's take that this condition does not hold. Because of this, okay, so let's simplify this. What does this imply? So if this condition here implies that delta I is less than or equals to 2 times square root by T I t minus 1. Okay. So if this condition is violated, we will take the opposite inequality and that will give me 2 times. So that will give me a lower bound, that is alpha log t divided by ti t minus 1. Okay. Now let us appeal to the third condition. Suppose this also is violated. Okay. Then I am going to take the opposite inequality of this, that will tell me if I just take this guy on the other side, it says basically mu I plus this quantity is lower bounded by mu I t. So just appealing to that, this is going to give me mu I of hat plus alpha log t by t minus 1. Okay. So what is this now? We have started with the left hand side, which is UCB index of 1 in round t, and now we have ended up with, so this is one of them, we have to take it as strict inequality, right? And we have showed that this is equal to UCB of I in round t. So if none of these 3 condition holds, what we have just demonstrated is the UCB of 1 is going to dominate that of UCB of index of I. That means ITI can't be the IT, the arm played in round I can't be I, right? Because anyway, arm 1 is going to dominate that. It would have been picked if nothing else, right? So we don't know, at least for sure, we know that I can't have been played in round I. So this implies that I t can be equal to I. Okay, so a contradiction. So now it is must be, now we have just proved that if arm I is played in round, a suboptimal arm I is played in round t, it must be that at least one of these must hold. Okay, next, based on this, we are going to bound now expected number of pulses of arm I. So before that, I am going to define, I am going to take u to be alpha log n divided by delta I square. So just so we made a small mistake here, right? When I applied this bound here, I should first get mu I times 2 alpha log n divided by t I t minus 1 here, because this delta I, the way it is defined here, it depends on n here, not t. But we know that we are considering this in round t, and in round t is less than or equals to n. So because of that, this inequality also holds, and rest of the things are fine here. Now we define u to be alpha log n by delta I square, which is a constant, right? Like, because alpha is some constant, n is the number of rounds, which is again constant, and delta I is a suboptimality gap, that is a constant now. So this quantity need not be integer, so we can take it to be simply the seal of this, but I will not necessarily write a seal all the time. Okay. Now how to bound the expected pulse of I. I am going to now write this. By definition, this is going to be summation t equals to 1 to n indicator of I t equals to I, right? anyway, I'm interested in the expectation. I'm going to write my expectation of T of n. I split it into two parts. First part is expectation of Ti of n, indicator that my of n is less than or equals to u plus, and the other part is expectation that my Tn of n is greater than or equals to u. Okay. Notice that this, when I said in round T, if I term is played, all at least one of this might hold, and that round T I could arbitrarily take it any round, right, between 1 to n. So I can take that that T to be the last round here, and now I am going to use that logic here. I know that because of this indicator here, that Ti n is less than or equals to n, this first expectation I can upper bound it at by u, right, where what is u here, the u is the one which I have defined here plus the remaining expectation. But in the remaining expectation, let me substitute the terms for Tin, which is defined to be Ti 1 indicator I t equals to I times this another indicator. Notice thus this indicator here, it does not depend on time here. So simplifying this, I am going to write it as expectation of so now this is indicator consists of indication is based on this joint event here, that is I term is played and the number of poles of I r till round n is greater than u. Okay, now at this point we are going to now appeal to this claim that we have made and proved. We are saying that if at any point arm I is played, right, and T of n is greater than u, that is this condition is violated here. For the nth round, so as I said, this is true for any n, right. Now we are saying that if this is the case, it must be true that if this is condition is violated, then other at least one of them other should hold, right. So because of that, it is going to be u plus expected value of integer 1 to n integer I t equals to I. If this is not this T I n is greater than u, then at least this or this should hold, right, either 1 or two holds. Now applying union bound, I am going to write it as u plus expectation of relation t equals to 1 to n indicator that I 2 equals to I comma 1 holds. Plus expectation that relation t equals to 1 to n indicator that I t equals to I 2 holds. Right. So I have basically simply applied the on this union bound on this indicators, right. So indicator of IT equals to I and 1 or 2 holding is like IT and 1 holds and IT or IT and 2 holds. Okay. Now pulling the expectations inside the summation and applying this expectation on the indicator, you will get that expected number of pulls of Ti n upper bounded by u plus summation of t equals to 1 to n probability that I t equals to I and 1 holds plus t equals to 1 to n probability that I t equals to I and 2 holds. Now further, this is the joint event. So if I just skip the IT equals to I part here, I will further get an upper bound here with that summation t equals to 1 to n probability that 1 holds and plus t equals to 2 t equals to 1 to n that probability that 2 holds. Now let us recall the definition of what was 1, condition 1. So condition 1 told us that the confidence interval of the I term, it overshoot and or overestimated the mean value of I. So okay, let us write it separately. Holds is same as saying that, that is probability that mu I hat minus alpha log t divided by t minus 1 is greater than mu I that round, and probability that is equals to 2 holds the same as probability that mu I 1 hat plus alpha log t divided by ti t minus 1 less than mu 1. Now these probabilities we already know how to handle, right? Because this is nothing but the estimate, and if you are going to take the mu I left hand side, this is the difference between the estimate and the true parameter being away from this quantity. And similarly, this quantity also we know how to bound. This is for I, mu I hat, and this is the estimate in the error of mu 1 hat. So both of them we know how to bound using our concentration inequality for our sub-Gaussian distribution. So I am going to bound your bound for this, and similarly we are going to get a similar bound for this.